All right, so you're gonna cut your cryoblock and collect sections onto a superfrost slide. So we usually cut 20 microns. So this is a 20 micron section. If you were to use paraffin blocks, then you would cut typical 10 micron sections. And the protocol basically explains like how long you need to air dry them. So here you would air dry for at least like 5 to 10 minutes just to make sure the sections are adhered to your slide. And once you're done with that, the next step is to do a post fixation. So we do post fixation with 3.7% formaldehyde. So the concentrations are in your handout. And we also add about like 0.1% of DEPC along with the fixation. And you'd fix this for about 20 minutes. So we usually use these jars. So we, I mean, this is not fixative, but this is typically how you would do it. So you can just put your slides in here. So it's like, can I have yours? Have yours. So, can I have yours, please? Thank you. Okay. Thanks. Okay. So I usually like fill this with fixative and leave this for like 20 minutes and incubate it for 20 minutes at room temperature. So once this is done, or in the meantime while it's incubating, you would prepare your antigen retrieval buffer. So this buffer has citrate and LDS. So citrate is like commonly used for antigen retrieval. Along with this, we add LDS, which is lithium dodecyl sulfate. It's a mild detergent, so it kind of like makes antigen retrieval work better. So you would prefer you would prepare that buffer, and once this incubation is over, you would swap the PFA, and you would add your antigen retrieval buffer. And the antigen retrieval happens at 70 degrees Celsius for about 30 minutes. So it's like, you need to like keep it warm. So you can also pre-warm your buffer in the water bath while this is happening. So once your fixation is done, you can just take your slides and put it in the buffer. So we usually just do it in a normal water bath, which is over there, just, yeah. So you do that for about 30 minutes. So once that's done, you take your slides out. There's no tissue. Just one sec. Hey, do you have one more of this? No? Oh, you have one more of this. Yeah. Okay, so once you're done, you take your slides out, and you need to make sure that they're completely dry. It helps that the slides were at 70, so the water tends to like evaporate faster than you're just leaving them at room temperature. So you can just leave them like this, or sometimes you can keep an elevated platform and leave them inclined so that the water just like drips off and dries. So the most important thing is to get rid of all the excess moisture, because you don't want any liquid in there when you put on the seal chambers. I'll show you how the seal chambers look. Okay. What's not coming out? Do you think you can try taking this one out? To get stuck. Yeah, this. Yeah. Sure, thanks. Thank you. Yeah. So you just leave it out to dry. Not too long. So I think I typically leave it for about 5 to 10 minutes. So these slides are not warm. If you took them out of the water bath, the water is going to evaporate much faster than it is doing now. And it's possible that you might have some moisture stuck on the slide. You can just take a Kim wipe and kind of like carefully wipe it around to get rid of the excess moisture. You guys can like pass slides, try it out, get a slide dry. I can give you the seal chambers to put them on. Just pass it out, yeah. Doesn't matter which one you get, it's cool. Yeah. Yeah. Over there.
Maybe we should talk about the cells.
Yeah, when it's drying. Can I have 6? Yeah, cool. Yeah. So these are the seal chambers. So there are like So these are the seal chambers. We order them from Sigma. There are multiple vendors who sell this. I'm going to cut and pass one around. So they typically have 8. I've already cut 2 out. So if you were to, if you're working with cells, in which case you're going to have like cells distributed uniformly on a slide or a cover slip, you would just peel this off and stick onto your slide. But if you're going to work with tissue sections, you can't do that because you don't really know where your section is going to be on the slide. So in that case, you're going to cut it out into individual squares. It's basically, okay. You can just pass this around. So if you look at it, it has 2 ports. Yeah. And you're going to use that to add and remove liquid. So right now, both sides are sealed. But if you look at it more carefully, there is one which actually has an adhesive peel and the one which has like... So make sure you don't take out the one which looks thicker. That's actually the top surface which has the port. Take out the one which has the flimsy adhesive.
Yeah.
It
seems the same.
I can show you.
Okay, one is thinner. This is thinner, this is thicker.
Just peel from this side.
Okay, these ones.
Yeah.
Show them and show me.
Okay. All right, so does everyone have one? I have an extra, which I already peeled. Oh, okay. All right. So once you're done peeling this, and if your sections are dry, so you would place this on your slide and make sure that your section is in the middle.
So the section is too big compared to this
one. That's okay. That's okay. So this also is sold in like multiple sizes. So depending on your application, if you have a much bigger tissue block, you can buy different sizes. This one's not right. You can wipe this. I can come back. Okay. So I'm going to put this on. So put that on and gently press with your thumb. Don't apply too much pressure. Just gently press it down. Yeah. So I usually stick them in such a way the ports are like lined horizontal. It doesn't matter. It's just like it's your preference. So I usually do it this way so that I can add my reagents on the left and remove them from the right. Yeah, yeah. It's up to you, but just make sure that you use one port for adding and the other one for removing reagents. You got that right? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. What?
Sigma.
Yeah, this is actually sold by Grace Biolabs, and there are multiple vendors who sell it. There's Sigma, there's Invitrogen, Life Sciences.
Yeah. What are they called?
Seal chambers, hybridization seal chambers. Yeah. You have the catalog number in your handout.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's it. So make sure that the slide is dry. You put on the seal chamber, press it down gently with your thumb. So now it's all fine. So the first step, so now you're done with your fixation. You're done with antigen retrieval, and you've added the seal chamber. So the next step is to add the hybridization probes. So that's basically the first step, right? So here, I think we have a premix. There's a high buffer, okay. Okay, so I have some probes dissolved in hybridization buffer. So you guys can like try adding into these ports just to get a feel for like how it is like to use these just once. We are gonna like do everything, but just for this. So the couple of things that you need to like make sure is always add from one port and remove from the other so that things get washed out more evenly. That's one thing. And the other thing is, if you're like beginning to use this, there is a possibility you might face bubbles or like chambers that are not completely immersed in solution. So when that happens, just remove all the solution from the other port, gently tap so that all the liquid settles down. So if basically if you just did this, all the liquid would just come down and then you can remove it. And then try to hold the slide like this and you try to like basically add the solution against gravity so that it pushes everything up. So if you had any bubbles, that should get rid of it. Yeah. You might have like issues with bubbles initially when you're not very familiar using this, but it should be fine like the more you use. Okay, so you guys have. And each seal chamber can hold about 50 microliters. So this is a small one. We also have a larger one. If you had like a bigger tissue block, that can hold up to 100 microliters. So it depends on your application. The nice thing about this is it limits the amount of reagents you use. So if your tissue is not too big, then there's no need to use a lot of reagents to cover a larger volume. Okay, so you can try adding.
15.
50. Yeah, this is the one. You can just pass it around. We had like some spare ones. Just set it up to 50 and pass. Is it set? Okay. Yeah, yeah, sure. Yes. You can just take and pass. Is everyone good? Are you good? Okay.
So, as I said,
I didn't set it.
Always make sure that you add
straight adding the 15 micro.
Once they're done, I can do once here, yeah. I just want them to do it first, yeah. No, just add it and leave it. We're gonna, so.
Oh, so some, I think that some came out from the side. Maybe it was not well attached.
Yeah, so if your seal chamber is not stuck well, you might see this, like liquid leaving out, yeah. This could be because either it didn't adhere properly or there was moisture there already, so the adhesive didn't work. But over time, you would.
It was inside, right? The water. Then I mean, in case this happened, we can leave because all the liquid is inside the air.
Yeah, but over time, your reagents would start leaking. Yeah. So, and if you had a different tissue section here, and it had a different probe,
yeah,
you don't want to mix. So, yeah. So. Yeah, I'm just going to show him how to add 50. Yeah, but I think that's. You'll kind of figure out what works best. Okay. That's okay. That's okay. Yeah, no, this is. Yeah. So once you add your hybridization probes, you would incubate this in a humidified chamber at 37 Celsius for about 2 hours. So I'm not sure. So the setup that we have here is a Hybe oven, which has a tray and a blotting paper. So it keeps the tray humidified. And basically, you don't want your reagents to like dry out because we're not sealing these ports. So I'm not sure like what setup you might have. If you don't have a Hybe oven, you can use like a box where you can like add wet tissue or like water below and place a slide above and like seal it. The only idea in using a humidified chamber is you don't want your reagents to dry out. So as long as you can like work around that, it should be good. You don't need a Hybe oven. Yeah, we just had one, so we're using it. So the Hybe oven is over there to your right. You can just show them, Yana. Yeah.
So basically, it allows you for a humidified chamber because you just add liquid and it keeps it moist throughout the whole time.
Yeah.
The only thing when you leave it overnight, I would add extra so it doesn't dry out.
It's just basically a blotting paper to which you add water in this taste. And if you didn't have this setup, you would do it in a box with like blotting paper and maybe like keep your slides at an elevation so that, you know, it just doesn't touch the blotting paper or stuff.
And you want to seal it.
And you want to seal it, yeah. So this step is 2 hours. Not so much of a problem with drying, but there is one step which requires overnight. So that's when you need to be careful. And if you persistently have issues with drying when you do the overnight step, you can also use an adhesive to seal the port and then remove it the next day. The only thing you need to be careful is when you peel the adhesive tape, you don't want to peel the chamber as well. So, okay. So assuming that you're now done with your hybridization step, this would be followed with 4 washes using the hybridization buffer. So this is the stringent buffer that I was talking about. So earlier we used like PBST, which was not that great. So this is a good buffer. So this would ideally remove all your excess unbound edge probes or edge probes that are just sticking to surfaces of the slide. So this is an important step which you want to do. So once you're done with this, and this is the same thing, you just like add reagents and remove reagents. So you would add, you'd replace the old edge probes with the new fresh high buffer, leave it at room temperature for 5 minutes, and you'd keep doing the changes 4 times. And once you're done with this, you would add a reaction mix that has circles and bridges. So this, say for instance, your edge probe was supposed to work with Psi-5, you would add the common bridge and the circle that is meant to work with Psi-5 to your reaction mix. And you would add it, and you would do the same thing. So you would take the slide and put it back in your humidified chamber at 37 for 1 hour. And once that is complete, you take it out. So now you're not going to do a stringent wash. You're just going to do a PBST wash. So what we have right now are the edge probes to which the bridges and circles are bound. And they're basically not in, so they're like bound partly to the bridge and the circles, and you don't want to do a stringent wash that's going to like get rid of them. They're not ligated yet. So you would just do a PBST wash to remove unbound circles and bridges. And then you would add your ligation mix, which has the T4 DNA ligase. So what the T4 DNA ligase would do is close the circle, and this incubation happens for about 2 hours, again in the humidified chamber at 37. And after you're done with the ligation, the wash that you're going to do is the stringent buffer wash. The reason why we do a stringent buffer wash is to get rid of unligated circles, which might like potentially cause problems. And so you would do a stringent wash that gets rid of unligated circles, and then you would add the 529 polymerase, which will start the rolling circle amplification. And that would happen overnight. So that's the step I was telling you about. So if you were working with cells, you don't have to leave it overnight. For cells, we do it like about 3 hours, 2 to 3 hours. RCA is good. You would see puncta in 2 to 3 hours. If you were working with tissues, we prefer leaving it overnight. It's totally up to you. But in cells, when we leave it overnight, we've seen that puncta become like really big. Basically, like the RCA has happened too long. So you see like huge puncta. So it's up to you, like how you want to do it. And so the next day when you come in, you would take these slides out of the humidified chamber and give a wash. And then you would add your detection oligos. So these are those oligos to which fluorophores are attached. So in our case, we started with a hybridization probe that works in Psi-5. So I would use a detection oligo that is tapped to a Psi-5 fluorophore. So you would add that, and that should go and bind to all your rolling circle amplicons. And then that's about like 1 hour at 37, the hybridization of the detection oligo. Then you do like quick PBST washes to get rid of excess oligo. And you can stain your nucleus with DAPI. We usually use DAPI in PBS to stain the nuclei. And and that's it. Then you would remove the seal chambers, add vector shield, and put on a cover slip. So I can just show you, removing the seal chambers is like pretty easy. So, hey, blade. I don't have one here.
There's like there. Some new ones over there and there's more.
Right there. Oh, okay. Okay. So you can just take one of these. Oh yeah, before you take out the blade, you need to mark where your chamber was, because once you remove it, there's no reference where your sample was. So we usually use a marker and kind of like mark the circle that you see here, and then use a blade and peel it off. So I can just show you how that works. Let me get a marker. Hey, one sec. Let me grab a marker. Yeah. So you can just...
Can't see it.
Really? Okay. Okay, so you can just put a circle just to notify where your sample was and use a blade. So this adhesive comes off pretty easily. So I just wedge between the slide and the seal chamber and just like pull it off. I mean, now it has liquid. I would get rid of all liquid before doing that. And just make sure you just don't like, you know, go all the way in and scrape it off. So that's bad. Yeah, that's it. So it's out. And so once it's done, you would just add vector shield or whatever is the mounting medium of your choice. And you'd put a cover slip on. And you're good to image. Yeah, so that's it. If you guys want to like try, I have more blades here, so just pass it around. Yeah, it's, yeah, removing it is pretty easy. So they used to have like a different company that sold seal chambers, which had like super sticky adhesive. This one is better. If you have any residual adhesive left on your slide, make sure you remove it, because when you put a cover slip, it's not going to be directly sitting on the slide. So when you image, you might feel like it's not flat. Done, I think. Yeah, I know, it skipped the whole thing. Yeah, but it's just that, you know, things that they might want to see. Adding and removing reagents is kind of pretty much all of it. Yeah, I know, pipette. Pipette without bubbles. So drying and bubbles are like two things that you need to like take care of. You don't want your slide to dry, then you might start seeing like edge pros being deposited in random places, and like you don't want that. Yeah, it's fine. It's fine. So this is if you're going to do just in situ. If you were to do an immunostaining after this, you wouldn't be removing the seal chamber. So you would add your detection oligo, you would wash off the excess with PBST, and you would directly move on to your immunostaining protocol. And once you're done with your immunostaining, you would add DAPI and then remove your seal chambers. Yeah, you would add the primary, so you would add the blocking, weight, add primary, weight, wash, and then add the secondary, wash, then add DAPI, and only then you would remove the seal chambers.
Does this experiment include some blocking?
No. The in situ, no.
No.
Yeah.
So we need to do
for the antibody, you would. And what else? So when you do the antibody staining, serum is not RNase free. So we try to like minimize damage to RNA by adding EDTA to all the reagents. So it says in your protocol, like, add EDTA to all the reagents or buffers that you use in your immunostaining. Yeah. And what else? So if your RNA degrades during your immunostaining, you would start losing puncta, because the way your rolling circle amplicon is tethered to the sample is through your mRNA. So you have your mRNA, the probe, and the RCA product, right? So if you lose your mRNA, then there's nothing to hold your rolling circle amplicon in place. And during subsequent washes, you would lose signal. So adding EDTA is one way to like minimize that from happening. Yeah. So. Yeah.
They can potentially use hydrophobic pen instead of chamber.
Yeah, yeah, they can. It's
and
just that,
evaporation,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
so you would
evaporation.
Have to, like, put maybe like parafilm or something.
How would you put it?
What?
How would you put it?
I do that all the time with antibody staining. If I have the,
use the pen. I think it's still messy.
Humidify.
Yeah, but it's very messy.
No. It stays underneath. You won't evaporate.
But how much reagent do you need?
More reagent,
yeah, this one is like minimal.
They work with bigger sections.
Oh, okay. So there's also like an other.
I was trying to show you.
Oh, he showed him. Okay, he showed him. Okay.
Out.
What?
You're out.
Okay. No, I have some. I do. Yeah, I do. There are bigger ones which you can use. It's
so
like.
We actually put the platform on the table.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, it's like that big.
Yeah. So it's like you can get away with 25 to 50 microliter of.
Oh, okay, okay. Yeah, yeah. Whatever works for you, but yeah.
I'm sure you can adjust the
problem. Yeah,
yeah. Just as long as you make sure it doesn't evaporate.
Yeah.
It's just be a little extra work to keep on
doing it, sure. Yeah.
Especially once you leave it overnight.
Hmm. The only reason we use this is minimal reagents, like 50 microliters. So it's like.
And it's really easy.
Really easy, you know, add and remove. It also gives you some control, like how you're adding and removing reagents so that the wash happens properly, yeah. And yeah, you don't want like salt or anything depositing or drying, because that's going to look really weird when you image. So anything else, or should we go to the microscopy room?
Yeah,
you can just leave this here. There are trash cans over there. We are done for here.